Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Recently, I started receiving some clips, some audio clips and some pictures also about boycotting some dates. And that is because Ramadan is coming, and the reason being is that these dates come from Israel. And as such, we Muslims, we must not buy these dates so that we can hurt Israel and inshallah liberate Palestine in the way as we starve the Jews. And before getting into this idea, because some people think that boycotting is an Islamic duty and there is a lot of mixed up out there. So I just wanted today, this pep talk here, to really let you know in what it is about boycotting. Is it an Islamic duty? It is not. What is the ruling in Islam? All these kind of things, so that inshallah when we do something, we do it fully aware and with full knowledge. My dear sisters and my brothers, one of the beauties that mankind have been endowed with is the brain. The human intellect is a powerful tool that helps us humans to make decisions, make choices, taking stances, defending causes, and what the brain is capable of is beyond measure and belief. When the intellect is used proactively and in a positive manner, it can lead to tons of good deeds. Humans are the only creatures, my dear sisters and my brothers, on earth that can differentiate between good and evil, right and wrong, tyrants and victims, or right and left. And for years, humans have used different ways and tools to express their support for what they believe is right and what they deem correct. Some used very aggressive ways to put their points through. Some of these ways cost human lives, and many wars were and are still being fought today to find out who is right and who is not. But war and battles are not always the ideal ways to fight for a cause, and people throughout history designed different ways to fight in battles with less casualties as possible. Propaganda, kidnapping, house arrests, cold wars, financial embargo, and boycotting, amongst others, were invented and discovered. Since our talk today, inshallah, is about boycotting, so what is of interest to us in this pep talk is the open-closed boycotting, i.e. cold-ish war between us and somebody else. But before diving into the topic at hand, a bit of history, because it's necessary to understand what comes after or before boycotting so that we are illuminated and our intellects will perform at their best. The whole thing started one day when someone called Charles Cunningham Boycott, who was an English land agent who lived in the 19th century in Ireland. He refused to reduce rent for his tenant farmers, and as a result of that nasty behavior, the local residents did not want to have any dealings with him. And as such, Mr. Boycott started living isolated. Nobody bought or did anything with him, and that's how the term boycotting came to be and was coined. It's the name of the guy who started all. So how effective is boycotting as a whole? And although, as I said, this term boycotting was coined in the 19th century, but it was observed in different means and manners throughout history. For example, Quraish used boycotting against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 3 years. And you remember Sha'ab Abi Talib? For 3 years, nobody married from them, nobody bought food from them, nobody sold them, and nobody. It was a complete embargo from all angles. And that was Quraysh boycotting the Muslims. And then after that, they started Iran, Syria, Lebanon, Iraq, and all these things. But it came after that. Before going any further, let me tell you what is the position of boycotting in Islam. There are no clear-cut evidences in the Quran nor the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that encourage Muslims or prohibit them from observing the boycotting, because it is a fighting technique and it is left at the necessity of the time. Although some people have, especially in Palestine, they have attempted to twist the necks of the scriptures, that is the Quran and the Sunnah, to make boycotting an Islamic act of worship, and as such, turned it into a halal haram matter. And the reason I said clear-cut evidence is because those who want to make it an Islamic act, what they do, they use something really nasty, which is also used today a lot by scholars and things like that, to turn something halal into haram. And that is what I call the escalating arguments from nothing to an Islamic ruling. For example, let's say selling women clothes is permitted, right? If you open a shop and you sell women clothes, that is absolutely halal, no problem at all with it at all, okay? And there are no restrictions whatsoever. So if someone wants to make owning a woman's clothes shop haram, all they have to do is escalate an argument. And here is how it goes. So they will start by getting you to agree with them that when women go out wearing sexy, tight, and provocative clothes, that is haram. And obviously, you being a good Muslim with not much knowledge would straight away say, of course, it is wrong. And it's not permitted for them to wear this kind of clothes and so on and so forth. And then when they do that, they will tell you, well, you by having a shop that sells clothes to women, you are actually helping them to go out in the street dressed up like that. What this means is if a woman buys something from your shop and she goes out and wears it, you carry the load just as she did. You carry the sin out of that. And as such, since women are not allowed to walk in the street with that, it is not permitted for you to have a shop and sell it. Now, when you look at it at emotional level, you say, yes, it's right. And I'm sure you can, if you think well with yourself, you will find that a lot of people build a lot of arguments just by using this escalation or escalating the argument. When in fact, the whole case of what they mentioned is absolutely nonsense and it is wrong. Owning a shop that sells clothing is absolutely halal, even if it is tight blue jeans. That's because every human is responsible to do with their clothes. Allah will hold them responsible what they did with it, not where they bought it from. This is not you selling something which initially is haram, like drugs and things like that. You're selling clothing. But what people use the clothing for, that's their responsibility. And this, as you can see, how it is that until 2002, a lot of shops in Saudi Arabia were forbidden to have, and they were, these are real truth, this is real data. They were forbidden because of this escalation of argument. Alhamdulillah, now they have wised up and scholars have stopped doing that. But here is the case for the boycotting. They will start telling you this. Look, the Jews are killing Palestinians. It's right or wrong? Of course you go, it's wrong. And then they say, where did they get that money from? Is when you buy from their produce, like dates here, Ramadan. As if the Jews now have nothing to do, the only way of getting armament is by selling dates. It's really funny. And then they will tell you, when you buy of the produce of Israel, you are helping the Israelis murder the Palestinians. You are, in fact, being a pro-Israeli. Is this correct? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. And I am not saying this for myself. Okay, the great scholars like Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, and a lot of other scholars, Al-Albani, and many of them are of the opinion that we should not mix emotions with religion. Our stories with the Jewish people doesn't start today or 70 years ago. In fact, it gets very, very deep in history. And it is throughout history of Islam, no boycotting has ever been documented or done to anyone. Even when Palestine was taken by the Christians for 200 years, not 70 years of now, Palestine has been away from the land and the hands of Muslims. And at that time there, the Dawla al-Abbasiyya, we were still an Islamic state and we had all everything. And this is about 700 or 800 years ago. So you can see, and Palestine has been with the Christian armies for 200 years. Even at that moment there, Muslims were still conducting business with the Christians, with the Jews, and we had absolutely no problem at all. Reason being, because it is not haram. We cannot stop someone buying or selling from a Jewish people. It's just un-Islamic to tell somebody, don't buy from a Jewish. Now they will say, well, they are our enemies. Well, here is for you. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Al-Madinah, he found the people of Al-Madinah having only one market. That market was dominated by the Jews. As usual, they love money and things like that. So what did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam do? He built another market. So now you have two markets. One competes with the other. But you know what he didn't do? He didn't boycott the Jewish market. And he could have done to the Muslims, because building the state at that moment there in the city of Al-Madinah, he could have said, do not buy from them, help our economy. But that was not the purpose of Islam. Always remember, Islam is a universal religion. It talks to everybody. So what did Rasulullah ﷺ? He opened another competitive market and made the best win. And that's exactly that. Then later on he lived, and they gave him hard time. They tried to assassinate him. They did plot against him. Did he do anything? Did he make an embargo on them or boycott their produce or anything? He didn't do anything. And at the time of his death, as in Muslim and Imam Ahmad, and also in the book of the Sunan, when Rasulullah ﷺ, when he died, he had his armor, his shield armor, that was ransomed with a Jew. Because one day Rasulullah ﷺ wanted to buy barley for his family, about 30 wasaq, that is about 30, 35 pounds of barley. But he didn't have money to pay ﷺ, so he gave his shield to this Jewish person. When Rasulullah ﷺ died, that Jewish man still had the shield of Rasulullah ﷺ. Now ask yourself a question. Couldn't Rasulullah have borrowed money from the companions to buy it? He could have. Couldn't he have bought it from Sahaba? They were people that had businesses. He could have. So why did he buy it from a Jewish person, knowing that they were, and they did betray him many times? Because, my dear brothers and my sisters, Islam is a very practical religion. So today, when you look at us today with the Palestinian issue and all that kind of stuff that's been going on in our time for so long, nowadays, some people are really doing their very best to turn in boycotting into an Islamic religious something. So much so that someday somebody told me, hey, if you buy that, that means you are killing the Muslim kids. And I said, astaghfirullah, ya khair, fear Allah, what's wrong with you? Why would you issue that statement that neither Allah said it in the Quran nor Rasulullah ﷺ said it in the Sunnah? Boycotting remains an individual non-Islamic duty. It's an entirely based on individual. If you, my brother and my sister, do not wish to buy the dates that come from Israel, hey, and you are happy without it, do it. Buy from somewhere else. And if I still want to buy those dates, do not frown upon me, do not look down on me or accuse me of anything. Always remember, this is business. After all, if Allah wanted to make it haram, he could have made it haram on us, but he didn't. This is not where we are helping someone. And also for your information, my dear brothers and my sisters, dates will amount to absolutely nothing with the amount of business that the Israelis or the Jews worldwide do with the world. In one transaction, they can get billions upon billions. And I really feel personally here that boycotting is something to make some people feel good about themselves, that they are doing something, when actually they could be doing far more better, proactive, positive jobs to help people. And I will tell you later on about my personal experience about these issues. In trying to help the Palestinian cause, a lot of people, as I said, they want to push forcibly the issue of boycotting as an Islamic duty, that you have to do it. And there is a great, huge danger in pushing that agenda on Muslims. Because what these people are doing, they are turning something which is halal, which is me buying from a Jewish, it's absolutely halal, into making it something haram. And this is absolutely dangerous, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nahl, Surah An-Nahl is what is known amongst the scholars of Quran as Surah An-Ni'am, is the bounties that Allah has given to us. Allah says in Al-Quran, وَلَا تَقُولُ لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبُ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ. And do not say to what your tongues describe the untruth of, this is halal and this is haram. لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ, so that you invent on Allah lies. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ الْكَذِبَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. Certainly those who invent lies on Allah will not succeed. What this ayah means is that people with their tongues, they will describe certain things that are halal, and they twist the necks of the scriptures until they make them haram. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here, وَلَا تَقُولُ لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمْ, because this is a description of your own tongues. It's not something that Allah has sent from heaven. And what do you say? This is halal and that is haram. And you start halalizing things and haramizing things. And to make things halal and to make things haram is a right to Allah only. And as I said many times before, the term haram, you can only use it where Allah has used it. You can, for example, yeah, smoking is not haram. It's not permitted. Because if you say it is haram, you must bring the text from the Quran that says that Allah has said the word haram. But for example, az-zina, fornication, we can say haram because in Al-Quran, Allah has used the term haram. So my dear brothers and my sisters, here it comes to me a question that has bothered me for so long. Where did our donations go? The amount of monies that we have sent to Palestine throughout the last 60 years is phenomenal. It's unbelievably phenomenal. Where did that money go? How can we see today in Palestine? Where is it? What has happened to it? Palestinians are as poor as they always been. They still ask for money as they always been. My dear brothers and my sisters, we have to wake up. Where is all the donations that have been sent to Palestine? All the monies, my dear brothers, we're depriving our youth here in England or wherever you are from the services that we can buy them with that money. Islamic centers these days, they only take our donations and money. Palestine help the Palestinian children. And our kids today are in the street taking drugs. Our kids in England don't know Islam at all. Our kids are being brainwashed and detonating themselves and killing people. Our kids today don't have an identity in England. Where is the money that we send to the children in Palestine? What has it made for them that make them having a good life? Or whatever it is. What I'm trying to get here is, where did our donations go? Let me tell you about my personal experience here. When I was about 10 years of age, suddenly I heard that they were building a city. And I was, mashallah, they're going to build a city. At that moment there, alhamdulillah, where I grew up in a big villa. It's okay. But there were a lot of people that were poor living downtown. So I thought they were, the government was building this city for the poor people. Only later on to find out that that city was built up for Palestinians. That was the very first time I ever heard of something called Palestinians, Palestine. And we were all excited to see what are these Palestinians and what it is. And alhamdulillah, later on we found all these trucks and these things and coaches and everything bringing people. And in no time, that city, huge city, was populated by these Palestinians. Where I lived, the city was absolutely fantastic. And suddenly, something started showing up in our city. Drugs, alcohol, and prostitutions. And the city started getting populated with a lot of nonsense that didn't exist before. Only later, a couple of years later after that, the whole city where I was living went into marches and they went into protests and things like that. What was the request? Was kick those Palestinians out. We do not want them here. They have brought us a lot of evil. I completely forgot that. I don't know what happened to that after that, but only the thing came back later on when I was at the university. There you go again. Where we had to pay, where we had to do things, the Palestinians didn't have to pay. Where our meek 3 months quarterly bursary we used to have was absolutely nonsense. The Palestinians were being paid in dollars. And do you know what it is? At the university, they were the ones known for, if you want to buy marijuana or hashish and all these things, you go to Palestinians. If you want to buy wine and drinks and things like that, you go to Palestinians, and also for prostitutions and things like that. So here, it started really from that age growing up with me. And you ask a lot of people with these experiences. Here in England, let me ask you a question. Show me one Palestinian Islamic center, or show me one Palestinian masjid. They don't build masjids. They don't care about Islam. Nowhere would you go there. My dear brothers and my sisters, we have to wake up to these things here. If Palestinians, and they are all over the world, they have the greatest number of PhD holders in the world. Yes, they are rich. Yes, they make money. But Islam, when was the last time you heard a group of a society or a community of Palestinians here supporting each other. Palestinians, they don't like each other. Even today, you have two parties in them, Fatah and Hamas. And you have the Palestinians of before 48 and the one 67 and the 74. Nobody likes nobody. So my question is, where did the millions upon gazillions of US dollars and British pounds go for the last 50 years? Today, when you go to the Gulf, you see a lot of Palestinian leaders. What are they involved in? Business deals with whom? With Israel. The wall that the Israelis wanted to build. There were some Palestinian companies that were building it and making money out of it. What I'm trying to say here, it's not buying a little date or that date that's going to change the industry and the economy of Israel. Israel has got more money, and you're dealing with the Jews, and the Jews are very good at dealing with the wealth and money. My question here is to you, what other things, and I'm talking here proactively, positively, okay, I'm not talking about killings and things like that. What other things can we do to truly help Palestinians? You know, if you don't buy a couple of dates for 2-3 pounds, Saudi Arabia and some prince and some business people, they would buy from Israel for billions upon billions. If you want to do boycotting, by all means, go ahead, do it. But do not make it an Islamic duty. I see women wearing the hijab and talking to business people. Do you know that these dates come from Israel? This is business. You cannot ask someone. All you can do is educate people about what happens in Palestine. And you know what the best thing is? Ask Palestinian businesses that do it. Give us an Islamic center run by Palestinians. We want to see some Palestinians present. As to sending the money, I personally, I don't send no more money at the West here to somewhere in the East, Palestine, or any other country. I want to spend my money here in England to support our youth and our next generations. All the money is being sent to Palestine, Bangladesh, Pakistan, this stand and that stand, and our kids here are being trusted to the streets and the roads. So, to recap my talk here is, there are absolutely no evidences from the Quran or the Sunnah that encourage boycotting or prohibit or anything. Boycotting, it's on an individual level, if you want to do it or not. Again, and as I said before, boycotting has been described as the weapon of the weak. Sanctions is the weapon of the strong. So here we are, the meek, weak people. And guess what? We have been doing boycotting for the last 50 years. What have we accomplished with it? Do we have any data that we know how Israel has suffered? Israel is being still strong and everyone else is doing business. It's just giving us these headaches every time. Don't eat this, don't eat that, don't do this, don't do this, don't do that. We have so many things that are halal on earth, and these days it's not, don't do it, it's Jewish, Jewish, Jewish. Rasulullah ate from the Jewish. He bought from the Jewish, and they gave him, and they even were about to kill him when they gave him the poisoned lamb. So my dear brothers and my sisters, we really, really have to become a little bit smarter. Albert Einstein said, the definition of insanity is always doing the same thing and expecting different results. That's exactly what it is. We don't have any feasibility studies. We don't know nothing how our embargoes are affecting anything. Nothing at all. We just, boycott, 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 and then we go sleep, and that's it, that's the end of it, and we've done something big. I think we should wake up, and I personally, Abdussalam Abu Hanifa, I strongly call on people to stop sending money either to Palestine or anywhere else. Palestine is getting enough money from the rest of the world, and to invest our monies here in England at educating our children, at saving them from the streets, at saving them from the grip of drugs, and at saving them from being brainwashed and detonating and exploding themselves. This is where we should spend our monies on. Today, our kids are in the street, and what? When you have a problem with your child, where do you run to? You've got nowhere to run to. And you would not certainly take your child to Palestine to find a solution there. So, boycotting, it's an individual choice. Do it. Don't push it onto people. If somebody sends you a message about boycotting, do not feel guiltized or patronized. If you want to not buy from Israeli dates, don't do it. If you want to buy it, buy it. I personally, if I see it, I will buy it. I have no remorse whatsoever. To me, it's a product and it is halal. That's where it all matters to me. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our eyes and take those fake emotions away from us and make us of those who listen to the guidance and follow the best thereof. And before I end up this talk here, as I said, it's far away from emotions, because I can get emotional and show you all the pictures of the little kids being killed and I ask you to boycott. But that, again, this is patronizing people and playing with their emotions and escalating arguments. And that is not what Islam is all about. Again, this is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp at 0044 78 76 40 8735. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، اشهد ان لا اله الا انت، استغفرك واتوب اليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمه الله.